Hello again, and welcome to another of the regular meetings of the Libertarian Alliance, which meet every, and you have to correct me if I'm wrong, every third Tuesday in the month at the union of the, give me a clue.
Institute of Education.
In Bloomsbury, here we are. Good health to you.
Yes.
And this week's speaker, this month's speaker, is Mr. David McDonagh.
Yes, that's what.
And he's speaking on the moral theory of Adam Smith.
So my main reason for wanting to give a talk on Adam Smith, Adam Smith's morals, is to refute the idea that economics is based on egoism, and because Smith's theory of morals arose out of reactions to Thomas Hobbes, which was the egoistic principle. Hobbes put forward the idea that everything we do is we do just because we want to do it. Therefore, the egoism is the only option. Buckler criticised this heavily, saying that Hobbes had got things wrong. Just because everything we do we want to do doesn't mean that that's the end that we do it for. If I buy myself a new suit, then I do it for selfish reasons. If I help an old lady across the road, then although I want to help the old lady across the road, and that's the only reason why I do it, I do it for the end of helping the old lady across the road. So he looked at it the other way. Hobbes just said, look, everything we want to do, we do because we want to do it. Therefore, there is only egoism. But Buckler said, Joseph Buckler, he happened to be a bishop, said that, you're looking at it the wrong way around. Look at the end rather than the person who's doing the action. Look at the end that the action is done for. And so therefore, if you have a large family and you buy some clothes for yourself, that's selfish. If you buy some clothes for your wife, that's for the sake of your wife. If you buy some clothes for one of the children, then that's for the sake of whichever child it happens to be, and so on. And if you do something for the baker and so on, well, the old lady across the road, and so on. So this was a different way of looking at it. And he thought that Hobbes's view was just based upon a sort of mistake. You know, he was right insofar as he went, that everything he did, he only did. I mean, Hobbes famously says, everything we do, we only do as a means to an end, or an end in itself. Buckler agreed with that as well, but Buckler said, look, all these ends in themselves aren't your own ends. It's sometimes your wife's ends, or the old lady's ends, or someone else's ends, whichever the action happens to be. So that's the main part of Buckler's attack on Hobbes. But it was elongated, and not all of it was completely successful. Part of it was celebrated. Part of it, the attack of Buckler and others on Hobbes. Buckler started this attack on Hobbes, Hobbes was dead. There was a fellow called Bramble who attacked Hobbes along similar lines, but less forceful, less cogently, while Hobbes was alive. And Bramble came up with the thing, which Buckler repeated, oddly enough, that if I see a child or even a dog in trouble in some sort of river, and I dive in to save that child or dog, then Bramble said, I don't think of myself, I think of the dog or the child or whatever it is. We're making the sort of, more forcefully. And I just don't think of myself at all. And Buckler went along with that. And Hobbes replied to Bramble, and he said, I said, what about the people who don't swim? Do they dive in? Which I thought was a clever retort. Buckler's attack on Hobbes goes on and on. He's also an attack on Descartes. And Buckler, interestingly, said for a Bishop of England, could we call him a primate? Anyhow, for a Bishop of England, it's quite interesting that Buckler said, human beings are a lot more like the other animals than Descartes and Hobbes think they're like, and the philosophers in general, and the church, in fact. They ought to realise that humans are far more like the other animals, and this started the road to the revival of evolutionary thought, which ended up in natural selection by going from Buckler through Hume, through Adam Smith, through Malthus, and then picked up from Malthus, first of all by Charles Darwin, and then some 20 years later, from Malthus again, and when he was in the Far East, by the other pioneer of natural selection,
Alfred Russel Wallace.
Yeah, reading the same reading the same book and getting the same thing. Oddly enough, this has even more forerunners because I don't know whether you're listening to the I don't know whether you're Radio 4 fans, you might not be. You might not be BBC fans. But I don't know whether you've seen the book of the week is absolutely Benjamin Franklin this week. Well, of course, Franklin, by the way, Franklin was pristine liberal and quite a good one. He was the only of the founding fathers of the USA to get rid of, I mean, he didn't do it at first, but he did do it after a while, after thinking about it, get rid of all these slaves. He was the first person to do that, and the only founding father of the USA to do that on liberal principles. Well, if you read Thomas Malthus, you'll see that Malthus himself is not only influenced by Hume and the others, Buckle and the others, but also by Franklin. So Franklin has a say in this too. But anyhow, it leads to the theory of natural selection, which this book is actually the theory of moral sentiments, published exactly 100 years before Darwin's book was published, The Origin of Species, in 1859. This was published in 1759, exactly 100 years before. And this is struggling towards adaptability, sort of evolution, sort of natural selection, but he hasn't got natural selection. He's struggling towards that. But anyway, he very often goes back. So it was a reaction against Hobbes, first of all in Buckler and then in others, many others, but most notably in David Hume and Thomas Hutchinson. And Thomas Hutchinson happened to be Francis Hutchinson. Francis Hutchinson happens to be the tutor of Adam Smith at Glasgow University. And now, Smith was really influenced by those two to write this book. But if you read through it swiftly, you may well think that he doesn't really, that he just follows these two, his mentor, David Hume, 20 years or so older than him, and his teacher, his beloved teacher, Francis Hutchinson. But in actual fact, if you read it closely, he's quite critical of these two. And you go, and ironically, his direction back is back towards Hobbes, because Hobbes said, what's important is that I wanted to help these other people, if you recall. And that's exactly what's important for Smith in morals. Smith dismisses the idea that that we don't think on our own and egoistically. He goes to the idea, his main idea is that of an impartial spectator, which we get by looking at others for a long period of time. As we're growing up, we look at other people, see what they're doing, and we judge them. And eventually we turn that sort of judgment on ourselves, a quasi-objective judgment of ourselves. And this might be called conscience, which Buckler said was God-given. This is what Smith calls the impartial spectator or the impartial observer. And this is socialized, learned as we go along. It's improved somewhat. We have, as we're criticized by other people, we develop a greater moral awareness, and we judge others first of all, and then we judge ourselves by the same sort of criterion. Now, Smith is of the idea that there are three principles of morals. First one is justice, and then we have propriety, and then we have benevolence. So he thinks benevolence is a virtue, but it's not on its own. It has to work with these other two. And he thinks the strongest of these is propriety. By that I mean what is proper, what is apt to do in society. And this is, if you like, this is the view of the impartial spectator. What is right? What is right to do in society? Now. So Smith's main point is an anti-Hobbesian one in the first place, although it's, as I say, Hobbes said the idea that, it's not a completely anti-Hobbesian. Anyhow, I'll read it out. And this is, it's more or less anti-egotistical in the sense that we do care about other people as ends, not just as ourselves as ends. But it's pro-Hobbesian in the sense that it is our own opinions. We think on our own, as it were, in this sort of thing. And it's only by imagination that we can imagine what other people are like. So I'll read the celebration. It's about the first paragraph of this book, and I'll read it out to get it right. It'll show how flowery his language is as well. How selfish soever man may be supposed, there are evidently some principles in his nature which interest him in the fortune of others and render their happiness necessary to him, though he derives nothing from it except the pleasure of seeing it. Of this kind is pity or compassion, the emotion which we feel for the misery of others when we either see it or are made to conceive it in a very lively manner. That we often derive sorrow from the sorrow of others is a matter of fact too obvious to require any instances to prove it. For this sentiment, like all the other original passions of human nature, is by no means confined to the virtuous and the humane, though they perhaps may feel it with the most exquisite sensitivity. The greatest ruffian, the most hardened violator of the laws of society, is not altogether without it. So basically, he says, no matter, you know, he doesn't say that we're all morally equal, we all have the same sort of moral outlook. We all have our personal, basically, I mean, finally, our moral outlook is a personal thing that we've developed and socialised over our lifetime. But it is remarkably similar to almost anyone else's moral outlook, you know, notwithstanding that. And so we develop this over our lifetime, and some people are more dastardly than others, as he hints there. But there is no one, and this is coming from Hume's 1851 book, where Hume says, I doubt it's moral sceptic has ever existed. If anyone has been, Hume says, I doubt if any man, any or any woman, has ever been quite amoral. And that comes from one of the celebrated sceptics. It's a piece of anti-scepticism. I think Smith just endorses that from Hume. So let's first of all, of course, the thing that I was arguing against to begin with, the idea that economics is based on selfishness and it's economic man, all that, of course, arises with John Stuart Mill much later. And it doesn't last long with him. There are other people who revert back to this sort of anti-selfish outlook, or Christian outlook, I suppose you could call it. In fact, the Reverend Philip Wicksteed, in The Common Sense of Political Economy, he has spread economics to, as his pupil George Bernard Shaw says, as being the art of life, but also incorporated morals, and it wasn't by any stretch of the imagination egotistical. So there's many economists, there are other economists who go back to the to something like Mill's Economic Man, and Gary Becker himself, who thought he extended economics, of course he didn't extend them any more than Wicksteed did, because Wicksteed extended them to the whole of life. Can't go much further than that. But looking at his fellow practitioners, you know, they thought that what he was doing was not economics at all when he applied the economics of the family and so on. And of course, so he met with opposition from the various colleges and so on. But he certainly wasn't doing anything innovative in the history of economics. And he himself often said that Adam Smith had a much broader view of economics, but Wicksteed had an even broader view than Adam Smith. So economics is not based on selfishness, but that was a. But now I'm going to have a look at the theory of Smith, because it's an odd sort of theory. Smith actually takes a fairly low view of human nature. He's not quite a misanthrope, but there are times when he's not far off being a misanthrope, I think when he was in his childhood, he obviously was reared in a sort of Christian household, and he got this idea that selfishness was bad, and he finds plenty of expert theories for thinking that the bias towards self-love is very vindictive. There's one passage where he says that more than half of the troubles in the world is based upon the bias that we have towards self-love and getting our things out of perspective in that way. I tend to think that's a bit exaggerated, but I think that's what he thinks. And he also thinks that he more or less agrees with, say, the all the political ideals that, prima facie, you know, anyone who comes up with political ideals for improving man, Smith tends to think at first glance they are bound to, they look as if they would improve man. But he says when you have a look at things closer, you'll see that there are all these vices that we see, and two of the vices that he goes on about at length are the vice of vanity and the vice of pride. So when you have a look at all these vices, you see that they have they are well adapted within society, and society itself is well adapted to itself. And one of the biggest things in Smith, which he often quoted from his late passages from The Wealth of Nations on the American breakaway of the American colonies from the from Britain in the War of Independence, or the American Revolution, as romantics called it, or, you know, whatever you want to call it. I first called it the War of Independence, the American, then, because I tend to think it's revolution, it's a Norset idea, a romantic idea. But still, Smith, someone said, oh, well, Britain is ruined now that America has broken away. And of course, Smith made the celebrated comment, there's a hell of a lot of ruining in great society. Now, of course, he doesn't think, but what Smith doesn't think about is the human race or society is that it's in any way, shape or form fragile. He thinks it's sturdy, and you know, he can take a hell of a lot. And of course, anyone who's of a libertarian persuasion who sees the government knocking all sorts of things out of society and society still surviving ought to agree with him on that. You know, society can take a hell of a lot of belting, and does take a hell of a lot of belting from politics. Now, so Smith doesn't have the LA insight that politics itself is a negative sum game and intrinsically wasteful and uneconomic, and that we'd be better off without it. But he does have an idea of all political ideals as being all right in a prima facie or first glance setup, but completely and utterly unfitted for society. And if they were implemented in any way, shape, or form, they'd make society worse rather than better. That he's utterly convinced of. And this is not because he thinks society is good. He thinks society is no better than it ought to be. But he thinks there's good things about it, and he thinks there's bad things about it. He basically doesn't seem to like the human race all that much. They are obsessed with self-love, and that's their worst fault. And their self-love biases them towards being unjust to others. So he has a look at this. First of all, we think of self-love, and we tend to favour ourselves above almost anyone else. And then we tend to favour our family, and then our friends, and so on. And when we see certain groups in rivalry to us, it might be, you know, for example, we might have our own nations. By the way, Smith is not an anarchist by any stretch of the imagination, and not even, I've just given his views of politics. He thinks it's dysfunctional. But he doesn't think that, he thinks that politics is supported by tradition and so on. And he doesn't want to get rid of politics. He wants to limit it. He wants it to rest. He wants laissez-faire, as it were. But he doesn't want a situation where he doesn't see it as many in the libertarian movement see it highly desirable to get rid of politics altogether. He hasn't got that anarchist thought. But he does think that the political ideals are almost bound to be dysfunctional. Now, he's got this idea that society is that most people in society are not all that good, and that envy is rife in society. We often get a lot of envy in society, and very often this destroys our pleasure that we have to take with other people, other people's success and so on. We envy them, but he does have a thesis about envy. He says we only envy those who we believe are slightly superior to us. If we take any action against our equals, those people who we think are equal to us, he thinks that's meanness rather than envy. And he thinks that meanness is not going to be as vicious as envy is. He expects dire things from envy. When he talks about envy, he doesn't mean like we might get, two girls might say, well, I envy your dress, you know. He doesn't mean envy like that. By envy, he means something where you're going to act on this and probably even do murder. Or you certainly have feelings for doing murder. Now, there is this this thing of this difference between thought and deed, where he takes a view which I've often thought was ridiculous myself for a long, long time. And I'll mention someone who he doesn't mention. I'll mention St. Paul, the effective founder of Christianity, as far as I can see, who actually thought that the thought was as bad as the deed. You know, I've sinned in my mind, even if I haven't sinned in fact, just by having the desire, these various desires that I might have. Now, Smith seems to think that, prima facie, this is perfectly right. If you have these bad thoughts, then you're a bad person. This is what he thinks. You know, always strikes me, I must confess, this strikes me as being absolutely bizarre. But anyway, he thinks this. And he thinks, but then he says, we have a look at how things are the world. People don't often worry too much about what people are thinking. What they worry about is deeds. And we say, and he says, even the law itself acts on deeds, not actual thoughts. And if it did act on thoughts, it would be like the Spanish Inquisition. You know, we would have nearly anyone would be suspected of doing all sorts of thoughts, and we might find that it would be effectively a reign of terror. So basically, he says I think he's being disillusioned with Christianity because he keeps on using phrases for what we might call God, which are not what a happy Christian would use. Like, for example, he says the actions of Jupiter, or the actions of the grand designer, or the actions of the author of nature, or even nature itself, he very often says, and this is why you might see him merging towards Darwin, he says nature has made things such that this, and nature wants this, that, and the other. So he is going towards the biological rather than, he says, as nature has it, we don't act on what people might be thinking about us, but only if they do something wrong to us. And the law courts itself is wise enough to only punish people for deeds, not for... So if you actually intend to commit a murder, and you actually even fail, and the law lets you off the hook, as it were, even though you probably only fail by mistake, you know, by an accident, and Smith himself thinks that, well, you're probably just as guilty as murder, you only fail by an accident. No, I'm afraid I have no sympathy for
this. There is a charge of attempted murder, but I'm sorry.
Yes, there may be a charge of... Yes, but it's not as serious as murder, is it?
Oh, no.
And it never would... You know, I mean, I'm not saying that... I'm not saying that the law doesn't pursue some of these things, but it doesn't pursue most... I mean, the law isn't worrying about what I'm thinking, not yet. I mean, I think there's a lot of lawyers who'd like this sort of thing to happen, but thank God they... thank God. Thank God they don't. Repeat the error. It doesn't make any difference. I mean, the fact that I make a mistake doesn't make any difference, just to be honest. So he says the hidden hand of Jupiter aids society, and Jupiter in his wisdom. But he said, but he does say this because he still thinks this. You know, he's sympathetic towards St. Paul's idea, as I'm not. I must confess. And he says, well, Jupiter has organised such that in this life we never will bother about thoughts, and that's why society functions. You know, we don't get hung up on these petty things that people might think. If there's no deeds, there's a difference between thoughts and deeds, and we look after that. But he says Jupiter himself at the grand tribunal, when we're all dead, when we all face the grand, Jupiter then will take all our thoughts into account. So, and he says, and Smith says, and rightly so, because as I said earlier on, at first glance, you'd think that this was the right thing to do. So he is sympathetic to this thing, bad thoughts. And this is, I think this is part of the reason why he doesn't like humans so much, because he's making too much of a fuss about their thoughts. You know, I mean, I quite like humans, but because I'm not really worried too much about their thoughts, as long as they don't hit me and so on, you know. They can think what they like, you know. so anyway, he does see this, and he sees the wisdom in not being too bothered about thoughts and so on, the difference between thoughts and deeds. And he goes on about this, it's on the success side as well. He says deeds matter much more than thoughts. And he quotes John Churchill, because again, he's quite conventional with his heroes. John Churchill says he's probably the greatest English general ever. And he says, but there might have been a lot of English generals who had more capacity than Churchill, but they just didn't have the opportunity Then the award didn't come along at the right time. You know, there happened to be a situation where, you know, these generals would probably have more ability, just didn't get into the war, and therefore couldn't show themselves. But he says this actual achievement of Churchill matters. And he says, with all our efforts, it's not our natural ability that matters so much, although that's important too, but it is what we actually achieve, if we actually achieve this, that and the other, as Churchill did, that matters more. So the deed matters more than the actual thought or the latent ability.
Churchill is Marlborough.
John Churchill, Duke of Marlborough, yeah. And he thinks he's the best soldier.
For the audience's benefit.
Up to his... Of course, he was before. I mean, many people say Wellington is the best. Actually, I tend to think that Churchill probably best. But anyhow, Wellington came after Smith, so he wasn't able to choose him. But anyway, whoever it is, he feels that it's bound to be someone better, but they just didn't get the opportunity to do it. And this matters, this sort of thing matters. So he has this difference between thoughts and deeds, and then he thinks this is self-love is almost bound to lead to what we might call selfishness. Now, Joseph Butler, who I mentioned earlier, did make the astounding, after criticising Hobbes on egoism and so on, Butler said, "I'm now going to say something which makes no sense in Hobbes' term. I don't think there's enough self-love. We could do, Butler says, we could do without having more self-love in society, so therefore we could, everyone would be better off. Everyone would, if everyone thought more of themselves, everyone would be happier, according to Butler. Now, Smith seems to seize on this and he says, I can't imagine how we can have too much self-love. If anything, we need a hell of a lot less of it, because it's absolutely vicious. And so he thinks it leads to a bias, and he thinks it leads to injustice towards others. And he also thinks, and he goes into a pet theory of his and a pet theory of many current philosophers and psychologists, and maybe of many people in this room, of self-delusion. He thinks that self-love leads to self-delusion, and that we can fool ourselves, and almost that we can lie to ourselves.
Brief pause.
Sorry. Now, this strikes me as being utterly absurd. I don't think that it's... in order to successfully lie, we need someone who is ignorant of the and stands a chance of being fooled by the lie. But Smith, and indeed many philosophers and psychologists around today, one person is the Popperian Agassi, Joseph Agassi, who thinks that self-deception is wanton, and that we can successfully lie to ourselves. There are quite a lot of them, a lot of psychologists and so on, who think that this, you're at home with this sort of thing. But I think it's intrinsically hyperbole. And if we put it in perspective, we'll see that it's absurd. And I think the account that Smith gives of it is absurd as well. But I think all the other accounts, Agassi's account is absurd and so on. So I think that this is just a myth, this self-deception. However, I don't think that that he's wrong on the bias and the, our tendency to not to fool ourselves, but to actually think more of ourselves than we should do if we were to think of ourselves objectively through what he calls the impartial spectator or the impartial observer. And if we think of ourselves as we think of others, and I think we do often think of this. In fact, I do think that this is often. There is a sense in which Smith's impartial observer, or impartial spectator, is in antithesis or against his thesis of self-deception. You know, because the impartial observer is taking an objective look at ourselves, and Smith actually says when he's giving an account of this self-deception, he said, I think this is a piece of incoherence now, I'm just going to cite. If only we saw ourselves as others think, see us, and if they, the others, could see what we know as well, which we're willing to keep back from them, then the sight would be absolutely unendurable. We wouldn't be able to face up. But the point is, you see, what he's saying there, and this is where I think it's incoherent, is that we do know this stuff that we keep up for them. And he talks about the vain man and the proud man for pages. And the vain man is the person who actually, in a phrase of mine, puts honour before honesty. That is, he's willing to lie and cheat, so you'll think more of him. Now, he knows he's lying and cheating, in my opinion. I think Smith thinks that he's under some sort of delusion here, but I think Smith is wrong there. And even in passages, I think he contradicts himself when he tries to outline this. I think, I don't think it's possible that the vain man doesn't know that he's vain. He knows all the time that there is a contrast between his abilities as he sees them, through this sort of impartial observer thing, and the abilities he's trying to get Joe Smith to think of him. And he knows that if he's successful with Joe Smith, then Joe Smith will think higher of him, the vain man, than the vain man thinks of himself, you see. But of course, all this would be, if Smith was right on all this, if Smith was right on the self-delusion, then he wouldn't even know that he's got Joe Smith to think higher of him. But anyway, and then there's the proud man, who's the opposite extreme, who is usually going to be honest, but thinks as a kind of a view of himself, which may either be right or wrong. We can always make these errors. But nevertheless, thinks that other people should think more of him than what they actually do. You see, and he feels insulted because people don't think enough of him. Now, he goes on about these people. It's a bit like actually in The Wealth of Nations, where he goes on and on and on about how wasteful imperialism is. And then at the end of The Wealth of Nations, he says, "But God, we're losing the American colonies. How terrible." Anything he'd been saying against the colonies was right, then he should say, "Good, let's get rid of the bloody American colonies, and the sooner the better. We shouldn't have taken up in the first place." And of course, I think that he's right in the latter and wrong in the former. In other words, I think Smith was made a bit of a fool of himself when he worried about losing the colonies. I think Cobden took the right position, Cobden following Smith. Yes, get rid of the bloody colonies. India is a millstone around England's neck. I think that was right. I mean, India was taxing England, but still. So I think, that's going to see the Wealth of Nations off the... But anyhow, he does a similar thing here. He goes on and on and on about the vain man and the proud man, and checks their faults and so on. But then at the end of it, he says, "Now, reader," he says, "what do you think about these two chaps? Most people think these two chaps, the vain man and the proud man, are... well below the average human being. These are 240 characters." He said, "But no," and this shows you how low he thinks of the human race, "they're way above the average human being. The average human being worse than that. I've been on about them. The average human being is worse than that." So you see, he does take a very dire is it accurate? Well, perhaps he's accurate, but I don't think he's accurate. Perhaps I'm wrong, and perhaps I'm deluded in the value of the human race. But anyhow, whether it's accurate or inaccurate, he takes a dire view of the human race. He takes a low position of the human race. And he then starts eulogising the vain man as above the average. And the vain man is amiable, he's generous and so on. He might be giving off his wealth and showing off his wealth in the vain man, but at least he's involves generosity. The proud man is honest, he always keeps time, he's a good friend, and so on. And these are the sort of things, these are the sort of coefficients of these vices that he thinks the politicians are overlooking. See, the politicians see this fault, selfishness or whatever it is, and they overlook the functional aspects of these vices. And Smith thinks what they should do is keep out of it, keep to your place. You can't improve society because your so-called ideals are going to make society worse, so keep out of it. Now, of course, the LA analysis would be, there's another reason why they keep out of it. They're a complete waste of money, these politicians. They are a negative-sum game. Politics is negative-sum. It's Cold War, and war is conspicuously negative-sum. It means systematically destruction of wealth. So, and politics is Cold War, so get rid of this, cut it back first of all as much as possible, but then get rid of it completely, with the LA, I would say. But Smith thinks, no, it's part of tradition, if you like. So he's a classical liberal as regards to an anarchist liberal. You see it all right in its own place, but its own place is limited. Keep it back, keep it at bay. And so therefore then Smith is very much So what I was going to say is that some people think that there's a conflict between the two books. But of course, that's because they think what I think I thought at one point, that not that there was a conflict between the two books, but I did think that Smith took a rosy view of the human race in the theory of moral sentiments. But now, close to rereading of it, I can see that he doesn't take a rosy view at all. He takes a dire view of the human race. And if anything, he takes a more uplifting view of the human race in the wealth of nations. So that I open it for discussion.
Very good. Very good. As Blanche Dubois might have said in the Streetcar Named Desire, I've always relied on the self-interest of strangers.
Yes, quite right.
And with that,
Smith's message.
We're open to questions.
Hello.
One over the back there.
Would it be fair to say that Smith is actually guilty of the crime or the sin that he actually decries against? He's guilty of self-love. Because I don't think you can possibly be a misanthrope and have a poor view of other people. Unless you've got a better view of yourself, you've got an exaggerated view of other people's flaws because of your own belief in your own goodness.
I don't think Smith is quite a misanthrope. At times I've been wondering whether he was or not, but I don't think he is. What he's saying is, I can tolerate the human race. I like them. I mean, he's reported to have been a very friendly chap. He made friends easily, liked people. And he certainly wouldn't pretend. He wouldn't play the hypocrite and pretend that he's not guilty of self-love. He knew. He's kind of like he's rather than a hypocrite, he's a sinner. In that sense, he would admit to being too full of self-love, too full of bias, too full of backwardness in this respect. And he'd be quite self-critical and wouldn't pretend to be any better than what he is, Smith. And so, he certainly doesn't think of himself as better than the average person. Not at all. That isn't Smith's. He may or he may not be better than the average person, but he doesn't. As far as we read through this book, it's not the man. It's not the writings of a man who considers himself above the average person. He doesn't. That's obvious from reading through the book. He just sees human beings, warts and all, and he says, I can tolerate myself, I can tolerate them. And tolerance is, this liberal virtue, tolerance. He's willing to tolerate people as they are, as they actually are, and make the best of things as they actually are, make the best of life. And he's dead against suicide. He hates the idea of suicide. He thinks it's a complete mistake, he's very much influenced by the Stoics, because the Stoics advocated suicide. About 10 or 30 pages saying why the Stoics are mistaken on suicide. Although not, he thinks it's vain and silly to have a law against, as there was in his time, a law against suicide. He thinks that's a stupidity. But he nevertheless thinks that suicide would be a mistake in almost any circumstances. I suppose that, you terrible cancer or something, you might take a different view of that. But under normal, most suicides are mistakes, according to Smith. So he in a sense he does like people, but he likes them. He doesn't think they're basically good. He thinks they're full of envy and so on, and full of terrible things. And he's only the impartial spectator. And of course, I should have said in the middle of the talk, that's what I should have said. The redeeming thing, of course, in Smith, is that we all want to be loved. We all want other people to love us. And so by the impartial spectator, we look at him. We do that which is proper in certain situations. And we do things to make a lot of other people love us. And that is a big redeeming feature in all this. We fall short through self-love, but we pull ourselves back through the impartial spectator, which tends to, as I say, tends to be almost a contradiction in his book. The impartial spectator more or less smashes, in my opinion, self-delusion and stuff like that. Still, there are two forces in the book.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Oh, here was a question.
You mentioned, if I heard you correctly, Smith believing in a sort of biological Darwinian basis for
nature. Nature adapts to things. The human race is well adapted. His view, actually, a good analogy would be Yeah, the way Richard Dawkins loves natural selection and so on, but he doesn't think it's any ethical. He thinks it's terrible. You know, he keeps saying that, you know, the law of the jungle is dreadful. We need society to correct the jungle. We don't follow the selfish gene. The selfish gene is downright immoral. But he nevertheless takes this view that the natural selection is as it is. Well, Smith takes a similar sort of view of human society. They're not as good as they should be, but they're almost bound to be like that. And you better be careful if you're going to improve them. I can understand how you want to improve them. It's natural to want to improve them. But it's so well adapted that you probably will mess it up and make it worse.
Right, yeah. It reminds me of the Humean view that morality...
David Hume.
Yeah, and it's something we bring to the world. And
yes,
many people construe Hume as a sceptic.
Yes.
Yes.
Although he's not a moral sceptic. He's an epistemological sceptic.
Yes, but
there's no justification.
Construe him as a moral sceptic too?
Oh, no, no. Hume himself, as I said earlier in the talk. I mean, Hume is Smith's bosom friend. I mean, they're very, very good friends. And Hume was probably the biggest influence on Smith. Hume says in his brilliant 1751 book, the inquiry towards the principles of morals,
yeah,
that moral scepticism is an impossibility and that no one has ever been immoral. No one ever.
But what I was going to say was, on one hand, it seems that Smith has this very humanistic biological formation view of morality, yet in a sense it also seems like he wants people to aspire towards a greater ideal, as though morality was more ideal than biological. I was wondering if you could comment on that. Which view would he be more inclined to?
I don't think they clash. You know, I think that we are animals, and we do have large brains, and we do have an idea of right and wrong. And I don't think they clash. I do think that my own view of morals is different from Hume's, and Smith's, and Hutchinson's. I think, oddly enough, although I don't agree with anything that Kant says, I think Kant was right to go back to Plato, and I think that Plato was roughly right, that the good is the ideal form. In other words, I do think it is a bit like when Hume's exercises his impartial spectator, he thinks it's, things are not proper. I think he's exercising something which is quasi-mathematical. You know, in other words, he's thinking logically that this is not neat, it's not good, it doesn't look so good. And so I think that people like the great follower of Newton, who Leibniz argued against, what's the man's name? Clark. I think Clark is roughly right. And he thinks that morality is basically a priori. Now, the argument against this is that pure forms, the big argument against Kant is pure forms will not motivate us. Well, I think that's wrong. I think Plato is right when Plato says we cannot wittingly err. In other words, if we see an error, it does move us. And it is logic. If you see an error, it moves us. We correct the error. And so I think that it's false to say against Kant and against Plato that the categories cannot motivate us. I think the categories can motivate us. And here I think Hume is wrong when he says reason is just a slave to the passions. I think reasons and the passions are mixed.
Is and ought to be.
Does Smith think that?
Smith tends to think that. Hume and Smith tends to think that, but Hume actually thinks that there's a separation and the passions are not so reasonable. In fact, the terminology, I mean, I would go, I'd agree with what Hume says, but I'd go through the terminology and put a different spin on it. And where he says irrational, I'd say rational. Basically,
that's a spin. Next question. Over there, yes.
Yeah, from what you said, it seems to me that Smith is setting out a position that's opposite Rousseau's romantic view of morality, where Rousseau says that man is a noble savage,
yes,
wretched by society.
Yes.
Taking a deliberately opposite point of view, that man is pretty wretched. It's like a kind of Christian view, you know, we're all scum,
yes,
before God, but we're capable, but society gives us the opportunity to sympathise with each other, trade with each other, interact with each other, and make us all better because of that. So he's actually sort of an anti-romantic ideal.
Yes.
I think all he's doing is making it clear that his view of man is not some sort of silly romantic idea of man as a noble creature, you know, that's intrinsically moral and everything about it is dragging his down. He's taking you, whether it's realistic or not, he just seems to be setting out a view like that, which, deliberately anti-romantic.
Both Hume and Smith love Rousseau. I mean, everyone loves Rousseau. I don't know why.
I hate Rousseau.
I've always hated him, yeah. I've always hated, especially that social contract, Christ. I've always disliked. I'm going to give a talk on Rousseau sometime and explain why I don't like him. But anyway, I don't like romance either. romance, I think the Enlightenment is the correct way of looking at things. In other words, you don't keep looking for enemies and us versus them. You try to bring about some sort of, make the best out of things, and try to bring about some sort of harmony. And I'm afraid Miss Rand and the Romantic Manifesto gets it exactly wrong, as she does in most of her books. I think it's a very bad way of looking at things to look for enemies. And if you like Winston Churchill and enjoy war, then romance is the thing for you. But if you hate war, and I've always hated war, I mean, that's the reason why I'm a liberal in some of it, get rid of, I mean, I hate the stupid things that's going on in Syria now, people just shooting each other, and I mean, that's absolutely terrible. That's the sort of thing I don't like, and that's the sort of thing that I don't. I think Cobden was right. Free trade drives out war. I think that's absolutely right. And when you read Cobden, you realise that pacifism is there all the time. I mean, I think they're the most... let's use the word in more or less, perhaps the original, they're the most pathetic pacifist writings that I've read, Cobden's, and they're all in favour of peace as against war. And so that's why I don't like romance, it's too warmongering.
No one has ever found the place where Cobden is supposed to have said, if goods cannot cross boundaries, soon armies will.
Ah.
It's the sort of thing you should have said.
Yes.
But it can't be found anywhere anymore.
Who did say that then?
Well, Cobden might have said it.
Someone
remember when you're talking about people like Priestley and Cobden, they say no one's ever found where Priestley made his utilitarian speech that converted Jeremy Bentham to utilitarianism. But of course, Priestley wasn't only a writer; he was a writer. He wrote over 100 books, but he also gave public speeches. And Cobden was a writer, but first of all, he was a person who must have talked more than once in every single borough in this country, up and down the country, going speaking, open air speaking all the time. So he's a public speaker, and he probably said it many times. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Oh, one up the back.
It sounds to me like this is Smith seems to be regurgitating kind of Judeo-Christian morals and applying them to the idea of free trade. He doesn't really seem to be going below that, what is morality and what it actually consists of. Like Kant did, for example. If you look, for example, I don't know if Marx had any theory of morality. I know the stuff I've read on Marx, he comes across certain things and he just says, oh, this is terrible, it's diabolical. And he doesn't explain why. I mean, he's obviously got a Judeo-Christian morality, and that kicks in when he comes across these things. He doesn't understand it himself, but he tells the reader what he thinks his own morality is. And I suspect that Kant may be guilty of this, sorry, not Kant, Smith. We'd be guilty of the same thing here, where he's got this Judeo-Christian morality, which evolved from Romanesque stuff, which again evolved from the Greek stuff. But they haven't really analysed it. They've simply applied it to the evolving technologies, which have allowed free trade and so forth, and this growth of free trade, they simply applied this. And I just wonder, is that really a theory of morality?
I think
not
so.
Like Kant,
I think I think so. I think his idea of the partial, the socialisation of the impartial spectator or observer is a description of the development of morality in watching other people. And of course, he has the idea, as I think I said, that morality is made of three aspects. You know, what is proper to do, benevolence and justice. You know, and he's concerned with the injustice that self-love inflicts on other people. He thinks that self-love leads to selfishness. But as I say, Butler made a massive distinction between those two and said there wasn't enough self-love. But Marx, coming on to Marx, Marx wasn't concerned with morality. He thought that there would be a new morality of the new society. But he had an insight, I'm afraid it was Buber's insight, but he had an insight that there was a movement within what he called the bourgeois mode of production to a new stage of production that would be far more superior in productivity and in everything else, and would get rid of the need for people to be employed, where we could have free access to the means of production and distribution. Now, this is just, I'm afraid, overlooking a little thing called the economic problem, which Smith outlines wonderfully well and almost puts the problem that ended me as a Marxist, the economic calculation argument, because Smith, towards the end of Theory of Moral Sentiments, says, what is the difference, you know, why do we need, and indeed he says this in The Wealth of Nations, he repeats this in The Wealth of Nations, why is it, I mean, in early on in The Wealth of Nations, he says, it's not from benevolence that we can expect the butcher to give us meat and the baker to give us bread and so on. We have to pay him for it, we have to address ourselves to his self-interest. Now, why is it the benevolence can't do this? Because this is exactly what Marx's idea is. Benevolence can do this. A society of communism will be based on benevolence and love, and we want to, I loved it because it promises an end to the problem of war, which was, as I said, my chief problem that's upset me ever since I was in my teens about society. And it promises an end of mass unemployment as well, because there's no need for employment in the communist society. But it's obvious why money can do the trick, whereas benevolence can't, because the division of labour, which is the work of Smith's life, the main work of the Wealth of Nations, goes right across the world, and always did go right across the world, even in the 18th century to China and so on. Now, benevolence and love can't go beyond our family and friends. It can't get to the four corners of the earth and organise a massive division of labour that we even need, even when we buy small things like toys for our children in the local toy shop. You know, that the thing, or even a pencil, as one American economist said, that no one knew how to fully make a pencil. These things require, as Smith says, multitudes and multitudes right across the world. And benevolence can't touch them. Money can. You know, the cash nexus can do. Now, Smith is saying in this book, he's not talking about the market in this book, he's talking about benevolence in this book. He's talking about what the sociologists would call primary groups, you know, where we do know one another. You know, like in here, we know each other. And, you know, in fact, this is, for a libertarian meeting that advocates the economic calculation argument of money, you notice no cash nexus is between us here. There's no charge to come to the meetings and so on. No cash nexus, right? And so we know, many socialists have accused me, you don't know, says, that this money society is based on primary groups. Of course I know that. We all know, we all should know that. We all should know that it is basically the benevolence group. And benevolence does work in our groups. We're friends and we have friends and we have families and so on. Benevolence can go that far. It cannot go right across the world to China or India or the United States or so on.
Well, but there isn't enough. There may not be enough benevolence, but there's also the lack of knowledge. You don't know what to do for best.
That's right.
Without the market order.
But money does do it.
Oh yes.
Money does it, and you don't need to know how money works. Well, your talk is going to explain how money works later on, but you don't need to know how money works.
It will. Oh. Ah, over there.
Yes. What would you say about the current European refugee/migrant crisis?
Well, you'd be in favour of laissez-faire, laissez-passer, of course.
Even though, from a libertarian standpoint,
laissez-faire, laissez-passer if we're going to have free speech, that means that it doesn't mean that the listener is forced to listen. And it doesn't mean that the people are forced to speak. Freedom, I don't say that freedom means that You know, if I apply for a job freely, it doesn't mean I have to get it. I may or I may not get it. You know, so freedom is freedom. And laissez-faire isn't that, you know, it isn't that that everything works out hunky-dory. I mean, Smith isn't, you know, he's far from being a utopian about society. He knows that there's envy, hatred, and God knows what, you know, all the hatreds that are out there. You know, he certainly hasn't turned a blind eye to that if you read his book. In fact, the country, he's rolling it a bit too much for my liking. I like the book, so I like the book as it is. But still, you know, he does roll in it a lot rather than turn a blind eye to it. So laissez-faire, laissez-passer doesn't mean that the people successfully settle where they want to settle. You know, they have to make do with second or third best or, you know, some sort of accommodation. But certainly wouldn't think that, you know, that you should coercively stop them. I don't think.
Just really following up on that, the way you describe Smith's philosophy, you say he takes a misanthropic view of humans.
Oh, that's not quite a misanthropic.
Well, not quite, but the way you talk about things like vanity and pride, you say Smith talks a lot about them.
Yeah.
I mean, this is pretty small beer, isn't it? I think most people are begging a little bit and maybe too proud, but it's not from that the ills of society are coming, is it, really? And it's not even from individuals, you know, being too violent, I would say. You know, the real problems come from the state, put it bluntly. I wonder what he says about that in his theory of morals, if anything.
Well, he says that he expects a lot of problems from the state, because the state, the politicians are bound to be ignorant. That's his main thing against the state. They're bound to be ignorant, they're bound to mess society up. He expects a lot of problems from the state. And he says, a firm will go bankrupt, and that will be unfortunate. People will want to avoid going bankrupt. But a state just taxes a bit more, and there's no limit to the ruin it can do to a country. I mean, the country can take it. There's a hell of a lot of ruin in society. But the state exercises, you know, does some work, you know, takes action on that, and in fact shows it to be the case. You know, the state abuses society far more than firms do, according to Smith.
I'm at the back there.
I probably haven't read The Wealth of Nations for about 10 years, but when I did read it, what I remember loving about it was Smith's obsession with logic and his need to look at the truth, to say that his idea was that, yes, people weren't always good, and therefore we need free market laissez-faire capitalism. And my question is this: if he had lived, let's say Adam Smith is superhuman and can live 300 years, if he had lived from the time he wrote The Wealth of Nations to now, and he saw the growth of both the UK and US government, do you think he could have been an anarcho-capitalist?
Oh, well, I think he would have been, yeah, but that's a very biased. Say, you know, as Smith said, we're all biased towards our own theories and so on,
yeah.
And that's I'm probably wrong anyway. But that, yes, I think he would be, yeah, of course I do.
The way I structured that or loaded that question was to say that he's logical, and why, you know, would he be an anarcho-capitalist? So you think
he would? Of course he would, yeah, it's a logical case. I mean, why? I mean, no one likes waste. And if the LA insight into the state, which Smith doesn't have, but I think he's right, that the state is negative sum, or it's intrinsically wasteful, then of course we want as little of it as we can have, and hopefully none of it at all. Yeah. So, you know, so I think that anyone who thinks the position out would be an anarcho-liberal, as I call them, rather than a capitalist.
I'm here first, then.
Genuine altruism and also self-delusion. You seem to endorse the view that genuine altruism is possible, rejecting the, I think it's called psychological egoism, that just because everything is just because we choose to do everything, everything is therefore selfish, that we can actually do things for the benefit of other people. You know, it's possible to be altruistic and benevolent and help other people.
Yes.
And I would agree, I reject psychological egoism.
Yes.
I mean, it seems wrong. And that you can understand. But you then also, but then you went on and said that you can't see that it's possible to lie to yourself.
And yes.
It seems to me if one's true, then it's possible. If genuine altruism is possible, then self-deception is possible. And I don't know what Agassiz's arguments are, that you've read and rejected, you haven't read them. But it seems to me that most people have either an inflated sense of their own self-worth or an overly critical view of themselves that is wrong from what an independent, impartial observer might assess about.
Yes.
Why isn't that self-delusion? If I constantly think I'm great,
well,
and independent observer would think, you know, you're not really that good, or I think I'm much worth less than I am.
Why is this self-deception?
That seems to me to be a reasonable explanation of self-deception in the same way that genuinely helps.
No, because you're not deceiving yourself. You're not deceiving yourself. I mean, I think delusion is far more coherent than deception. You know, so if you say self-deception, I mean, I don't know what a self is doing then. I think we do have delusions. I mean, you put anyone's beliefs, if you could put anyone's beliefs on the table, as it were, from the head, I'm sure that a number of them would be false at any point in time. In other words, any point in time, we have certain beliefs which we think are correct, but are false, and they are, you know, before the psychologists started messing around with it and saying something particular about delusions, they would be called delusions, just mean false beliefs. So I think delusion is rife, but self-deception, i.e. lying to yourself, if I lie to myself, if I say I'm going to live forever, and you know it is what I think is false, and therefore I'm trying to persuade myself that it's true, I think that this is futile, because I know that it's a lie. So that's why I think it can't work.
But if you say, yeah, that is false because I know it's a lie, in the same way, I can't ever think it's ever because I'm always doing things for my own sake. It seems to be either going to take a very formal and strict definition of both of these things, and you have to reject both as impossible. You can't have genuine altruism, and you can't have genuine lying to yourself. Or you can take a more charitable interpretation and appreciate what people psychologically do. And yes, when people mean to help somebody else, they mean to help somebody else. And when people have an overinflated sense of their own self-importance or an overinflated sense of their own lack of self-worth, that seems equally licit to the psychological.
No, no,
it happens all the time.
I think Butler's criticism of Hobbes was half right, and he's right in this sense, in the sense that I said, I'll repeat what I said in the talk. Hobbes said, everything I do because I want to do as a means to an end or as an end in itself. I think that's perfectly correct, and Butler thought that was perfectly correct. Now, Hobbes said, I want to, the reason why I help the old lady across the road is because I want to do that. Now, Butler would agree with that, but the point is, Butler would say, you're making some sort of grammatical mistake here. We're not interested in the fact that you want to do everything you do, we're interested in the fact that when you do this for the old lady, she is the benefiter of this. Now, when you buy yourself a new suit, you are the benefiter of that. When you buy something for your wife is the benefit of that. In other words, it isn't denying that everything you do because you want to do, either as a means to an end, either as a means to an end or an end itself. He's accepting all that Hobbes is right, but he thinks that Hobbes is confused because he's not looking at the object of any action. Now, so I think that's right. I think that's perfectly coherent.
Yeah.
However, if I lie to myself, what's futile in that is that I know, I know the lie is a lie. What I can do is I can lie to you and hope that you're not sensible enough to see that I'm lying. In which I might be wrong. You might be sensible enough to see that I'm lying, but at least I stand a chance with you because you have a chance of being ignorant of what that I'm telling a falsehood, whereas I don't stand a chance of. Don't stand the slightest chance of seeing that I'm telling myself a falsehood.
People do all the time. You wake up in the morning with a hangover in a skip.
Yeah.
Not very often.
And you think, what a wretched, awful person I am. But you're probably lying to yourself, you're probably not that bad. And then you wake up, you have a greasy breakfast and...
You're not lying to yourself, dear.
You get yourself a shine, you're feeling a bit better later on. You're like, feeling great. People lie to themselves all the time.
Let's have a few examples.
That's genuine lying to yourself.
No, you're not lying to yourself. When people are upset, they go in for hyperbole, right? You know, a man and his wife has a row. And she says, I'll kill you if you go off with that Rosie again. Right? Now, she's not being dishonest there, but she is being insincere. There's a difference between what that silly Christian called cheap honesty. What's his name? The fellow who wrote The Lion and the Wardrobe. What's his name?
C.S.
Lewis.
Clive Staples.
He said that there's cheap honesty, and he said the atheist is cheaply honest. And he said he went deeply. He took Francis Bacon too seriously. He said Francis Bacon says the superficial thinker says there is no God, but he thinks deeper and he goes back to religion. Perhaps I just haven't thought deeply enough. But I don't think that many people do go back to religion. But still, that's what Bacon said, and C.S. Lewis thought that it was right. The difference between cheap honesty and sincerity. Now, I think there is a difference between cheap honesty and sincerity. When we're going for hyperbole, we probably I would say none of that is lying. When the wife says, I'll kill you if you go off with Rosie, she's not lying. Now, she's exaggerating, she's going in for hyperbole, and when it comes down to it, when he does go off with Rosie, she doesn't kill him. She might divorce him, but she doesn't kill him. But you say things in hyperbole, and you say them honestly, but you don't mean them sincerely, i.e. when you come to think about them, you change your mind. Now, changing your mind is easy. There's an attack that silly Aristotle, call him silly Aristotle, a bit of a pleonism. Silly Aristotle made an attack on Plato when Plato said sin is quite absurd, and this is one of the reasons why I think Christianity is absurd, because he's got the concept of sin is quite absurd. Socrates and Plato said we can't knowingly err, therefore if everything we do either because it's morally neutral or we think it's perfectly moral. Now Aristotle, I used to think that sin was an idea that Christianity introduced, but apparently before Christianity, Aristotle saw that this was against common sense. He says, of course we can do what we know to be wrong. Of course we can do it all the time. You know, I know it's wrong to drink, yeah, I'll drink. I have 5 pints of Guinness, I know I shouldn't do it. Well, he's wrong, because the person who has 5 pints of Guinness doesn't think that it's wrong to do that. He thinks he's right to do it.
Not after the 4th pint, no.
Whenever he thinks it's wrong, he stops doing it. Mm. You know, as soon as you think drink, if I think drinking this water is wrong, I wouldn't do it. No, of course, I don't think it's wrong. But the point is this. Aristotle said, we change our mind. Of course, that's a dream with Plato rather than...
That's it,
him.
That's what it is.
But when we change our mind, earlier on we were honest. And now we're even more honest, we're even sincere. And we've realised that earlier. So the girl, when her husband goes off with Rosie, she said she'd kill him if she goes. She said, oh, I didn't want Frank to go off with Rosie, but I'm not going to kill him, I still love him. But anything. It's just that I didn't want him to go off with Rosie. Now I might have to divorce him, which is a thing I don't want to do. Anyway, I just didn't want him to go off with Rosie. So all of this is honest, but some honest statements are insincere, but insincerity is not lying. It's just cheap honesty.
Quick question. What would need to happen for this to be falsified? Because I don't see how you can... If this is a theory about people, I don't see how you can test this. You seem to have a circle. You seem to say, if someone says something, then that means they believe it. And so,
of course.
There's no way of testing this. It's just a circle.
I'm not a scientist. It is a bit like saying Popper is wrong because his own philosophy of science is not itself a science. Well, of course it isn't. It's philosophy. It doesn't matter to me that you can't refute this. What does matter to me in the thing that Adam Smith adopts is that it is incoherent. And what I find in the Popperian legacy and other people, defenders of self-deceit, is incoherence. And so therefore then, I don't know what will refute this apology for rationality. However, I do know that the opponents seem to refute themselves by their own incoherence.
Well, I think, one more here, I think.
But when people say, for example, I've been kidding myself, what would be your explanation for that? What are they?
Oh, I think they're just it's just hyperbole. I mean, we all do indulge in hyperbole and in figurative speaking. I mean, but that doesn't mean we don't mean our hyperbole, or we don't mean something by it. I mean, we might be aware that it's hyperbole. You might, language is full of metaphor and so on.
I think I have to jump in at this point. Chairman's advantage. Sometimes we realise that, look, the signs were there all along. If I'd taken a critical view of my opinion, my judgment, and I said, look, don't be a sap. It's fairly obvious that he's seeing another woman or whatever it is. Yeah. You know, don't be a fool to yourself. No, you haven't deceived yourself. You said, right, I wish to deceive myself. Press button, I'm deceived. No. What the point is, you haven't really turned your critical apparatus upon that particular conjecture.
And that's always the case. I mean, we can't turn our critical apparatus on everything.
That. Yes, there's nothing beyond that.
As I say, it's a good Popperian sort of thing, but however, I didn't pretend it was science to begin with.
Sorry, did you say that Popper is incoherent or that self-deceit is incoherent?
I think self-deceit is incoherent. I think, is Popper incoherent? Well, that's a question for a talk on Popper.
Indeed. and for another day.
Because he knows I'm a Popperian, and he put the Popperian question, what would refute this? What would you accept? That's the Popperian question. What would you accept as the refutation of this stuff that you're on about now? It's not. In other words, he's saying what you're saying is not scientific, and I grant him that it's not. I'm a philosopher, not a scientist.
Theorising is separate from
right.
science.
No, we have to end sometime. We're going to end now. The conversation will carry on
in the bar.
Outside, in the bar, right? Thank you very much. Thank you, David.
You're welcome.